Good morning, everyone. Today we will continue with the joint time frequency analysis. In the yesterday's class, we have discussed about the different aspects of joint time frequency analysis, and we have seen what do we mean by the mean instantaneous frequency, group delay, and what is Heisenberg-Gabor inequality, then localization of the signals, and all these things. We have discussed and we have seen there were some fallacies in the Fourier transform which led us to search for new transform domains or new analysis domains where we can analyze the signals in both time and frequency domains at one go. Okay, so our last class was our last question was that is there any need for other tools for characterizing signals in time and frequency domain? Okay, so this we got it from the analysis of the mean instantaneous frequency and group delay functions. Okay, so we have seen though mean instantaneous frequency and group delay, both of them, they provide very good analysis when our time bandwidth product of the signal, it is much greater than 1. However, when the time bandwidth product, it comes near to the Heisenberg-Gabor inequality limit, the lower limit, then over there are certain there are certain problems over here, and the mean instantaneous frequency and group delay, they provide two separate information and they do not corroborate each other. However, if the time bandwidth product is much greater than 1, then MIF and GD, they both of them, they represent the same curve. Okay, however, when we are analyzing any signal, we do not have the control whether our signal, the biological signal, as they are non-stationary in nature, so we do not have control over there, and it may so happen that under some pathological condition or some diseased condition, the time bandwidth product may change as compared to the normal healthy biosignal components. Okay, so under that case, we may have an erred judgment during the analysis of the signals if we use mean instantaneous frequency or the group delay as the analysis for analyzing the signal. Okay, so then we had the question, is there any need for other tools for characterizing signals in time frequency domain? The answer obviously is yes, because you cannot be working with a system which will give you differential results when there is a change in the parameter. Okay, so considering this, the higher level joint time frequency analysis, they are classified into two categories. The first one is the first class of solutions. It is called the anatomic decompositions. That means the signals, they are being broken down into smaller components. Over here we have STFT, short time Fourier transform, which we have already discussed, and we will be discussing over here also today in bit in depth. Then we have time scale analysis and wavelet analysis. Okay, out of these, I will mainly be concentrating on short time Fourier transform and wavelet analysis. Okay, then there are second class of solutions. Okay, so these are called the energy distribution. Over here, the energy is being calculated for a particular signal, and the energy is being plotted in the joint time and frequency domain. Over here we have WVD, it is called Wigner-Villet distribution, pseudo-Wigner distribution, and Cohen's class analysis. Okay, so over here I will mainly be discussing the Wigner-Villet distribution and the pseudo-Wigner-Villet distribution. Okay, so in joint time frequency analysis, we will be basically discussing about the STFT, wavelet analysis, Wigner-Villet distribution, and signal pseudo-Wigner-Villet distribution. Okay, out of this, the STFT and wavelet, they are they deal with the atomic decomposition, whereas the Wigner-Villet and pseudo-Wigner-Villet, they provide you information about the energy distributions of the signal. Now, before we get into the in-depth of the various transforms, over here we need to see the time frequency plot of different time frequency analysis. Okay, so here we will be taking four examples. The first one is the Shannon, second is the Fourier plane, Gabor plane, and wavelet plane. Now, if you look over here, so in all the cases, your time the x-axis is your time axis, and y-axis is your frequency axis. So in Shannon's analysis, what happens if you see, we break the time component, okay, we break the time component, and we analyze the we take up all the frequency component at one go. Okay, so this is in the Shannon's analysis. Okay, in Fourier analysis, we take all the time scale signal, and then we what do we call we break up the frequency axis. Okay, so in Shannon's time frequency plane, basically we are having good time resolution. In Fourier domain, we have good frequency resolution. Okay, then we have Gabor, where both time and frequency axis, they are broken down, and over here we have both time resolution and frequency resolution. Okay, and time resolution and frequency resolution, what do you mean? You mean that in this particular period of time, you will be able to analyze whether the frequency of the frequency of the signals in that particular instance of time, within this time, whether they are in the 0 to say 100 hertz, or 100 to 200 hertz, or 200 to 300 hertz. These are all examples, so you can have any other intervals also. So within that interval, within which of the interval or intervals you have the frequency component, so you are localizing it. So if you see the localization of the signal components, like the frequency components within a particular period of time, it is better in Gabor analysis. Okay, now in all the three transforms what we have discussed over here, see, Shannon, Fourier, and Gabor, in all of these, whatever the section we are taking, whether we are taking the section in the time domain or in the frequency domain or in both time and frequency domain, what we are doing, we are taking fixed windows. Okay, we are taking fixed windows. Okay, now when we go to wavelets, in wavelets the scenario changes. Okay, so over here we have time, and here we have frequency. Okay, so in time, if you see, when we are in the lower frequency domain, if you see the time scale, it has been sorry, in this one, that time scale, it has been broken down into two parts. Okay, so when we go towards slightly higher frequency, it has been broken down into four parts. Then again, when we go towards the higher frequencies, we have wavelet coefficients, or we have the time domain which has been broken down into larger compartments. That means, so however, what is happening, your time scale is the same. So what wavelet is doing is that if it is analyzing low frequency component, then it is using longer window. However, if it is analyzing higher frequency components, then it is using smaller windows, smaller time windows. Okay, so this is of advantage. Why? Because in our last class we have discussed, suppose I give you a time window over here, it is delta t, say for example. So suppose when you are analyzing a what do you call a low frequency signal, it will need a longer time window to analyze the signal. Okay, so you will be able to analyze the low frequency signal in a larger window frame. Okay, however, when you are using this long window, you are losing the time resolution. That means, what would happen, suppose if you have, say, 1 minute signal, you have to use, say, 0.5. You have to use the signal component of 0 to 0.5 to analyze the low frequency component. Okay, but over here you may have high frequency components also overridden over the low frequency component. So in all the other what you call transforms, you had fixed windows, right? Now, since you are having fixed windows, they would not be able to analyze both low frequency and the high frequency. So once you have fixed, the window is fixed, and whatever the results you get, you get. However, in the case of wavelets, what is happening in the case of the low frequency component, the larger window is being used. Whereas if you have a higher frequency component, in that case you are using, sorry, it is something like this. It goes up, then okay, it is something like this, right? So what is happening now, if you see, when you're having high frequency component, you are using low delta t, right? Now when you're using low delta t, then what is happening? What frequency components are present in this first fraction, you can segregate it from the lower fraction. Whereas for the low frequency component, you need the full window for the analysis, this full window for the analysis. So for the analysis of the low frequency component, it is using the full window. However, For the analysis of the high frequency component, it is using the smaller windows. Okay, so the windows in wavelet transform, they are flexible in nature. They are flexible in nature, and this is an important criteria. Okay, any questions? Okay, then let's move over here. Now the next thing is the STFT signal. In STFT signal, what you are doing basically, so say for example you are having this signal XT. So this signal, it is being multiplied with H star U minus T. So over here we have a XU signal where U is the dummy variable, dummy time variable basically. So this signal, original signal, it is being multiplied with H star U minus T. Okay. Now once it is being multiplied with that, we are finding out the Fourier transform. So what is this H star U minus T? If you look over here, the H star U minus T, it is nothing but a window. If you see from 0 to just above 100 and from around 150 to infinity, there is no amplitude values of this H star U minus T. So what it is basically doing? It is basically creating a window, okay, and multiplying the signal and multiplying itself with the signal to get some component. And then if you consider this as the signal component, then what you are doing, this equation is for the Fourier transform, right? So what it is doing basically, it is getting small portions of the time domain signal and then it is calculating the Fourier transform. So it is similar to the Shannon time frequency plane. So it is having fixed windows in the time domain. Okay, so it is multiplying with the first time frequency plane. In this window, it is getting multiplied, it is getting the signal, it is then calculating the Fourier transform. Okay, then it is plotting over here at this time what are the frequency components they are present. Then it goes to the second component, time component. It extracts the signal within this time component and then it calculates the Fourier transform. Okay, so in this way, what it is doing, it is combining the activity of the Shannon time frequency plane and the Fourier plane. Because if you see in the Shannon plane, we have time resolution, and in Fourier plane, we are having frequency resolution. So when we are combining these activities of these two planes, we are basically taking into account that we have a good time resolution, we have a good frequency resolution. Okay. Anything you need to ask? Any doubt over here? No? Okay. Yeah. So this is the squared modulus of the STFT, short time Fourier transform of the word Gabber. Okay. So when you speak Gabbard, Gabor word, then these frequency components, they are being generated. Okay, so speech signal analyzed in the time frequency plane. Okay, so if you see near to 50 hertz, what are the frequency components? Now, if you remember, we talked about mean time and mean frequency, and then we were talking about time distribution and frequency distribution. Okay, so if you see over here, we are having 50. So the mid of this point over here, we have a point say around 50. We are having a point around 150. So we have a mean time of 50, mean frequency of 150. However, this is the mean component. However, we have a dispersion in the frequency domain. We have a dispersion in the time domain, right? So I hope you are now able to understand what is mean time, mean frequency, and frequency distribution and time distribution. So I am talking about this slide over here. The average time, average frequency, time spreading, and frequency spreading. Okay, so it's time spread. Yeah, it's time spread or time distribution. Okay, now if you see in this section, approximately at 150 to 250 in a domain, if you see, you are having frequency components at different levels. Okay, so this is what the time frequency analysis, it helps you to get what you call in-depth information. So how the frequency is being distributed over time. If it would have been the normal Fourier transform, what you have got? You have got the amplitude and the frequency, and you would have got that, okay, we have got around some 50 hertz component, okay, some 50 hertz components in there, then approximately in the 250 to 200 we have some peak, maybe this would have got something broader like this, and then we would have got some components at around 400 to 500, and then above 450 we have some component like this. Okay, we have got only four peaks, but at what locations, time locations, these are present, we could not have identified. Now since we have applied the window, we have taken say 0 to 50 milliseconds what you call signal component, and then we have gone for the analysis, so we have been able to get the components. I just gave an example to get such kind of what you call plot, you need much more smaller windows. Okay, then only you can get this thing, otherwise the resolution will be affected. Okay, so you have to take smaller components if you calculate the Fourier transform. Again, you take a smaller component, you take the Fourier transform, then only you will be able to get the proper resolution. Okay, however, as I told you before, there has to be some balance which have to be met out, because if you take a window which is too small, then it would not be able to analyze the low frequency component, and you will miss upon the low frequency components, and during that analysis you will be getting the getting results which do not have any meaning. Okay, then we have this Heisenberg Gabor inequality. So the first one is the direct impulse. Okay, direct impulse, we all know it's just an impulse. So when we are talking about an impulse, it is having a very good time resolution. Okay, but if you see, the frequency resolution is skewed over here. Okay, so if you see over here in this STFT this thing, so you have a signal in here, and then you have this thing, you have taken this perfect time resolution using the impulse response. See, it is having some window. We know that even though we talk about the impulse signals, they have a small window, but that window tends to zero. Okay, so when you have this, so you get this energy density. Okay, so if you see, if you take the direct impulse, the frequency resolution, it gets screwed up, right? Now, in the second case, we have the window h is chosen as a constant. So when the window h is chosen as a constant, so that means you are taking the full time scale over here in this case, and then if you see in this region, okay, in this region, so what is happening, you are getting a straight line, nearly straight line, and these are some artifacts. Okay, so you are getting some straight line. So what is happening, you are getting a good frequency resolution, but your time resolution, it is skewed. Okay, so if you use a direct impulse, then your frequency resolution is skewed, and if you use a constant window h which covers all the time components, then your time resolution is screwed, but your frequency resolution, it increases. Okay. Now, this is a frequency hopper signal. Okay, this is another signal which is used for the analysis of the time frequency signals. Okay, time frequency, joint time frequency components, the TFA components. Okay, so over here, under ideal condition, if you would have wanted to look into the STFT, then you should have got these components. If you see, there are four frequency components. First one, second is slightly higher than the first one, then third one is slightly higher than the second sinusoidal, and lastly there is a decrease in the frequency, and it is having the frequency components which is equal to the first component. So if I segment it as 1, 2, 3, and 4, then 1 and 4, they would be having the same frequency component. Now if you see the ideal time frequency representation of the hopper signal, it would have been something like this. It starts with 0, it ends over here. As soon as it ends, the next segment 2 starts, and as soon as the segment 2 ends, the segment 3 starts, and as soon as the segment 3 starts, the segment 4 starts. Okay, however, in practical practicality, we do not obtain this kind of signals. What we obtain? We obtain this kind of spectrograms. Okay, so what happens over here? What is happening? If you see, a window length of 128, it has been used. Now, what is happening? It would have been a specific length, but it is overshooting that region. So there is frequency spread, there is time spread, and in between we have an energy, sorry, we have energy localization where the energy content is higher. Now in the second one also you get some spreading in both the direction, frequency and the time domains. Same in the third segment, same in the fourth segment. Now if you see, due to this what has happened, there is some overlapping of the frequency components everywhere in each of the segments. There is some overlapping. Okay. Now this is for a specific window length. Now let's see what happens if we reduce the window length. Now if you see, if you reduce the window length, so what is happening? The overlapping in the time domain, it has reduced. The overlapping in the time domain, it has reduced. However, there is an increase in the frequency spread in all of this component. The overlapping in the time domain, it has reduced, but the frequency spread, it has increased. Now, if I increase the window length, now if you see, the frequency spread has reduced, but the time spread, it has increased. Okay. Now this is one of the problem of the STFT spectrograms. Okay. When you try to get a better resolution in the time domain, your frequency component or this frequency resolution, it gets screwed up, and vice versa. If you want to achieve a very good frequency resolution, the resolution in the time domain, it would be screwed up. Okay. So again, some examples. We are having a signal with two Gaussian atoms, 1 and 2. Okay. So and over here a Hamming window H, it has been used, and the size of the window is 65 points. So you get this kind of spectra. Okay. Now if you see carefully, there are some shadow over here, there is some shadow over here. So we can barely make out that there are two signal atoms over here. Okay. So the thing is that it is difficult to discriminate the two components in time. So what I have to do over here, I know that there are two atoms. So if I have to resolve these two, what I have to do? I have to increase the time resolution. Okay. I have to increase the time resolution. Now, when I have gone for the increment in the time resolution, by reducing the size of the window to 17 points, if you look over here, it was previously 65 points. Now I have increased the time resolution by decreasing the size of the window to 17 points. Now I can make out that there are two atoms, they are present. However, what is it has resulted again? There is an increase in the frequency spread. That means your frequency resolution has degraded. Okay. However, the most important thing is that the two components which were present in the original signal, they can be easily distinguished. Okay. Now, when you go for this kind of analysis, you will find that any given signal YT, which is made up of two signal component X1T and X2T, you will be having one component for the signal one signal one component for the signal two, and one crossover signal which has components for both X1 and X2. Okay, so that is creating this interference over here. Okay, now if we have two parallel shoves, so if you use a short Gaussian analysis window, the cross terms that are present between the two this FM components, what are the cross terms? This component, this R component, this is the cross terms. Okay, so what happens when you are using a short Gaussian analysis window? Your frequency resolution is screwed up. See, there is some cross term effects between these two shoves. How does a shoved signal look like? It looks like something like a straight line over here, and since we are having two sharp lines which are differing by a particular frequency band, so we should get these two lines, the upper one and the lower one. Okay, however, since we are having the cross terms, due to that reason we get this kind of problem. Okay, so over here, if we use a short Gaussian analysis window and for particular period of time, if we have two frequency components, then there are high chances that we will get the cross terms over there. Okay, now if we use a long Gaussian window, when you are using long Gaussian window, you see, we are getting cross terms in the frequency domain. So, if you use a shorter one, when you are having very good time resolution, your frequency resolution is going wayward. On the contrary, if you are trying to increase the analysis window, then your frequency resolution it is increasing, and you are having the cross terms in the frequency region. Okay, so this is one of the major problem with the STFT transform. Okay, now how can this thing be resolved? There is no way you can resolve this problem. The only thing is that if you can separate the two sharp signals by a higher bandwidth. Okay, so this bandwidth in the frequency region, if you can increase it, this distance in terms of frequency, then only you will be able to get rid of those cross terms. Okay, but practically it is not possible all the time. Okay, now this is an ECG signal, and then we have STFT spectrogram. Okay, so this is the time, frequency, and how the energy localization are present at each period of time, and their amplitude, and which are the important characteristics points that it has been shown over here. Okay, then STFT in denoising. Suppose I have a way 50 hertz sine wave with uniform noise. Okay, now if I so this is the STFT spectrogram of the signal which I have shown you before. Then you go for the thresholding, and during the thresholding what happens? The signal components with the larger energy they are selected, and the other are removed. And then if you go for the inverse short time Fourier transform STFT, then you get back the signal component. Okay, there will be some deviations. If you see, the height of all the signal components are not same. And why this is so? When we talk about the white noise, what happens? Suppose you are having the 50 hertz sine wave. So when you talk about the white noise, the white noise itself would contain some 50 hertz component. So when you try to reduce this 50 hertz, the uniform white noise, some of the components of the original signal would also be removed. Okay, so this is one of the problem in any kind of filtering. But however, you can reconstruct the signal in a better way. So over here, the ECG, it has been corrupted with the 60 hertz noise. And if you see over here, so what is happening? There is a band at 60 hertz. Okay, and when you go for the threshold filtering, you get it over here, right? Now, if you see this P wave, it has reduced significantly. Why? Because when we talk about this, what do you call this ECG signal, it is having frequency components, say 0.5 to 100 hertz. In some books, you will find 120 hertz component. So it has got components even in the 60 hertz frequency region. So due to that reason, some of the signal components will also be of the ECG signal will also be removed. This is the ECG signal with uniform white noise. So if you see, the patches are present all over the place. Okay, and then you can apply the threshold filtering, and then you can get the signal. Okay. Now next comes the Wigner-Willet distribution. Okay, so in Wigner-Willet distribution, if you see, we are having two signal components. Okay, now both of them, they are x. So that means there is an autocorrelation. But what do you mean by this t plus tau by 2 and t minus tau by 2? So tau, it is the dummy time variable. Okay, so what it is doing basically, suppose you are having a signal, so it is taking a time tau. Okay, so from this tau, it is taking a signal tau. This region, the blue region, it is t minus tau by 2, and this region is say t plus tau by 2. Okay, now what it is doing, it is trying to find out the autocorrelation over here between the first segment and the second segment. So what it is doing, it is trying to find out the autocorrelation between these two parts. So there is a short-term autocorrelation in Wigner-Willet distribution. Okay, and then it is finding out the transform. Okay, Fourier transform, if you see, in general it is a Fourier transform, right? So it is basically finding out the Fourier transform of the autocorrelation of the signal, short-term autocorrelation of the signal. So this is in the time domain and this is in the frequency domain. Over here also, you will be finding that there are some cross terms. Okay. Now, this is the, what you call, Wigner-Willet distribution. So structure of the interferences between two components with different locations in time and frequency. We can notice the change in the direction of the oscillation as we change in the period of this oscillation. So these two components, these are the main signal components. However, in between you get some cross terms, and as you move the cross terms away and away, these atoms away and away from each other, see, the cross term, they becomes localized and they do not interfere with the signal components. In one way it is difficult, but in other way we know exactly where the cross term will appear. Okay, in Wigner-Willet distribution, where the cross term will appear, we know the region, and if we can estimate that these are the frequency components which are there and at which location the crosstalk will come, we can easily detect those things. So this is one of the advantages of Wigner-Wiele distribution. Now, if we increase the number of frequency atoms which are present in the signals, now if you see, for these two, we got one crosstalk. For these two, we got another crosstalk. For these two, we got another crosstalk. And for these two, we got another crosstalk. Now, for all of these, due to this interaction, at the center also, we have got a region of crosstalks. Okay? So we can see there are many interferences which are present. Okay? Now, this is one of the main problem. Now, this problem can be partially solved if we go for the pseudo Wigner-Wiele distribution. Now, over here, what it has been done is that a window has been used just like in the STFT. Okay, so you have the autocorrelation function, then that autocorrelation function, it is being multiplied with h tau. Okay, then the Fourier transform is being calculated. Okay. Now, if you see over there, since we have applied a window in the time domain, window it provides a frequency smoothing operation. And due to that, if you see the effects or the crosstalks in the frequency domain, which were in this way, they have been removed completely, right? They have been removed completely. However, if you look into the crosstalks which were spreading over the frequency region, they have increased. Okay, so the pseudo Wigner-Wiele distribution, it allows you to get rid of the crosstalks which are present in the time domain. However, it increases the crosstalks which are present in the frequency axis. Okay. Now, the problem arises if you remember, I talked that for the joint time frequency analysis, we should use analytic signal. Now, if you do not use analytic signals, then see the number of crosstalks, it's too much. Okay, so this is why while you are going for the analysis of the signals in the joint time frequency domain, we should take care of the fact that the signal should be converted to analytic signals. Okay, the signals should be converted to analytic signals. Okay, so with this, I will stop today. Wavelet transform, it is in itself, it's a very long topic. So in the next class, I would like to cover that one. If you have any question till now, you're free to ask me.
So what
No?
is the physical significance of cross terms? Is it like noise or disturbances in the signal?
Yeah.
Isn't it?
See. When you are trying to go for the calculation of the Wigner-Wiele distribution of your signal components, X terms and the Y terms, okay? So you are getting the Wigner-Wiele distribution of X term, you are getting the Wigner-Wiele distribution of the Y term. So this is your desirable region or desirable components. Okay? However, since you are going for this correlation function over here, you get another cross term value, okay? And this cross term you do not want, but due to the mathematical reason, you get these things. This was same with the STFT also. If you've seen, we have discussed over here also. If you're having two components over here, and then it was more what do you call it was clearly visible when we went for this analysis of the signal, which consisted of two sharp signals. See, these crosstoms effects, these were there. So over here also you are having this thing. So whether you are going for the spectrogram S or the Wiggler-Wiener distribution, you will have this crosstorm effects. So these are basically unwanted signals. Excuse me.
Okay, sir.
Anything else? No? Okay, then we will then discuss today.